This morning we're going to talk about the altar of God. And, you know, a lot of what we do in the church, in church life, in the church world is symbolic of what took place by the design of God when he instituted the tabernacle, the temple worship in the Old Testament. And so this is just a design of the Lord for us to follow today. We've been talking about the fact that some people think, well, Old Testament means it's old, it's outdated, it's not relevant any longer. But we talked last week about how when God designed the tabernacle, the temple that they worshiped in the Old Testament, he used heaven as a template. And so it's not Old Testament, it's actually future. And so our worship is something that God wants us to be a part of today. And it's also rehearsal and practice for worship in the future. If you have your Bibles this morning, open to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. I'm enjoying this. It's going to lead us into Easter. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday. We're just 2 weeks from Easter. And Easter Sunday, we're going to talk about, we're really in the realm of sacrifice right now. In those two services, Jesus gave us the greatest illustration of sacrifice that you'll ever see on the face of the earth or in all of the heavenly realms. So if we want things to be done on earth as they are in heaven, then I believe we need to do on earth what's being done in heaven. And in heaven, they worship the Lord all the time. They stand before the throne of God. They cry, holy, holy, holy. They're amazed and overwhelmed by the things of God that take place, by the presence of God. We left off last week talking about how our identity is wrapped up in what we worship. Our worship proves how much God is worth to us. We worship what we value. We worship what we identify with. And one of the Old Testament words for worship is defined bondservant. We touched on this just a little bit last week. How, you know, there are people that had to be a servant because they owed a debt. That was the kind of the Old Testament form or even New Testament form of slavery in some ways, because I owed you a debt. I borrowed money from you. The way I paid it off was by serving you, by being a slave to you, a debtor to you. But there are a lot of people that even after the debt was paid off, that they had such an affinity for their master, the one that they served. They had such a love and a belief in what they were doing and in their vision. They continued to serve them, not out of obligation, not because of the debt. The debt was paid, but they began to continue to serve them out of just a love and just an identity with that person, with their vision, their values, just a love for them. And so these servants were called bond servants. And if you look at the letters that Paul wrote, just about every one of them, he starts off by calling himself a bondservant of the Lord. We don't serve Christ because we have a debt. He paid our debt. Hallelujah. He paid our debt on the cross through his blood. Our debt's been paid. We don't serve him out of obligation. We serve him because we are bondservants of the Lord. We are not slaves of God. We are bondservants that serve him out of our love for what he's done for us in our life. A bondservant is free, but they choose to serve their master out of love, lifelong service to their master because of the love. And so many people in the kingdom of God identify themselves as bondservants. And this identity thing is very important. I was thinking about it this week just to kind of help you guys understand and give you an idea. You know, we identify with a lot of different things. And I was on the internet this week and Twitter and Instagram, and there's little blurbs that you can put on there, and it really kind of identifies yourself. People identify who they are. This is Glenn Burris, the president of the Four Square Church, and he identifies himself as disciple, husband, dad, grandpa, president of the Four Square Church. That's his identity. Our identity is wrapped up in what we worship, where we spend our time, our energy, our attention, things like that. There's a lot of different people that have a lot of different identities. Here's somebody that you guys might know very well. They're one sentence on Twitter. Says, spends my days helping others. Spend my days helping others. That's Katie Miller's Twitter account. That's her identity. She identifies with helping other people. And I didn't change this for this series. It's been this way. Mine says, servant of the Most High God. And it's interesting. You can find out what people's identity is by how they identify themselves, whether it's on the internet or where. Donald Trump's, you know, he tweets a little bit now and then. Says 45th president of the United States of America. So You know, look at yours. How do you identify yourself? What do you identify with? I am identified with my Savior, Jesus Christ. I worship Him. He is what I value most. He is what my life is wrapped up in, and He is the center of my life. And my identity, my security is found in the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is one of the struggles with people in the world today. Their identity is wrapped up in something false. They find their security in things that are not secure. We need to find our identity and our security in the Lord Jesus Christ. In Romans chapter 12, in verse 1 and 2, Paul writes these words. He says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And so we started out this series talking about singing and how in the Old Testament the Bible says they would come in to the tabernacle courts, into the gate, with singing in their heart, with rejoicing, with thanks, with praise. But that was only the beginning. The next step in the worship process of a believer was the word sacrifice. We bring the sacrifice of praise. Praise is great, but if there is no sacrifice, there is no worship. You're just singing a song. If there's no sacrifice attached to the song, you're really not worshiping. The principle of worship is sacrifice, that we need to come into the presence of the Lord willing to sacrifice something to God. Right inside the gate, the first thing they would do was they would come up to the altar of sacrifice and they would give to the Lord a sacrifice, something of their worship, something of their substance or sustenance, something that belonged to them, whether it was an animal that came from their flock or vegetables, fruit, or whatever, the produce that came from their farming, things that came from their livelihood. They would bring those things and sacrifice them to the Lord. In Genesis chapter 22, in verse 5, we find in the story of Abraham when he took his son Isaac up on top of the mountain. This is something he had waited for years, a great blessing from God to have a son. He's up in age now, something he had prayed for and believed God for years to have a son. And he finally gets that son, and he takes his son up onto the mountain. But before he does, he tells his servants, he says, stay here with the donkey, for the lad and I are going yonder to worship. What was he going to do? He was going to sacrifice his son. And that word sacrifice and worship are so attached together that Abraham said, we're going to the mountain to worship. I'm going to take the greatest blessing in my life, the thing that I identify with most in my life, the thing that I've been believing God for my entire life, and I'm going to sacrifice it to God. That thing that wants to consume me more than God. You know, having that child, I think it consumed Abraham's life. That thing that wants to draw me away from the attention that is to be given to God. And, you know, sometimes we can worship our children over worshiping God. We can worship a person over worshiping God. And so Abraham said, listen, I'm going to take this thing that God has blessed me with and make sure that the blessing doesn't become greater than the blesser in my life. That the thing that God has blessed me with is not something I worship more than the God that blessed me to begin with. Amen? So he says, I'm going to take this blessing and I'm going to lay it on the altar. This is worship. We are going to worship. We are going to take the blessings that God gives us in our life and put them at the feet of Jesus because they are not greater than the God that gave them to us. Amen. But you know, there's a lot of people that they do that. They worship their blessings over the blesser. They worship the things that God has given them, the opportunities that God has given them, the income, the job, the employment, whatever it is that God has blessed them with, they worship more than the God that gave it to them in the first place. And this is part of our worship, is to take those things and to lay them at the feet of God. The practice of worship without the principle of worship is empty. Without the principle of sacrifice is empty. Worship becomes powerful when we enter into partnership with God in the fellowship of His sufferings and being conformed to His death. That's what it says in Philippians 3:10, that we are to be conformed to His death, to share in the fellowship of His sufferings. That's part of worship. Jesus Christ laid down His life. He laid His life down. They didn't take it from Him. He gave it. The Bible says He could have called a legion of angels to take Him down off the cross, but He gave His life willingly to the Lord. That was His sacrifice. That was His worship. And so we need to follow in His footsteps and be conformed to the image of His death and the fellowship of His suffering. And so ruling with Christ must always flow from a partnership of dying with Christ. I've been crucified with Christ, Paul said. It's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. That speaks of identity as well. Amen? So we need to learn how to die to ourselves and die to our past and die to our flesh so that Christ can live in us. This is all part of worship, is sacrificing our agenda, sacrificing our aspirations, to sacrifice those goals, those agendas that we have in life so that God can arise. John the Baptist said these words once. He says, I have to decrease that he might increase in my life. I don't know about you, but I want an increase of Christ in my life. So Abraham tells his son Isaac, we're going to worship. So everything that we do in demonstration to God is not worship unless sacrifice is involved. You know, there's a lot of Christians that do a lot of things in demonstration to God, but it's not worship if there's no sacrifice involved in it. Worship has to involve sacrifice. Amen? Are you with me this morning? Sacrifice is a key ingredient. Worship calls for the sacrifice of anything within us that seeks our identity, our security in secular things, in worldly things, in ungodly things. We have to sacrifice those things. Where is your security? Where is your identity? What is it wrapped up in today? If it's not Christ Jesus, if you don't introduce yourself as a child of the Most High God, a servant of the King, a believer, a lover of Jesus Christ, then your identity might be more wrapped up in something else than it is in Jesus Christ. And you need to identify. I'm not saying you can't call yourself a teacher or whatever your occupation is, but don't let that be your identity. Amen. Let Jesus Christ be your identity, because that job may come to an end. You'll retire someday. And, you know, it's funny because you think, you know, Pastor, you're just kind of saying something here that I'm not tracking, I'm not following. You'd be surprised how many people, when they have their identity so wrapped up in a person or a thing, and they lose that person, that thing, they're lost. People, they get retired, and for so many years, their entire identity, their entire life has been wrapped up in who they are and what they've done in their job. And now that's not there, and they don't know what to do with themselves. They have no identity outside of that. That's why you see so many people that have a hard time retiring, because they completely have lost their identity. They don't know who they are. God wants you to enjoy life, and he wants your identity to be wrapped up in more than your what you do, than your work. Your identity must be wrapped up in the Lord Jesus Christ. Worship, number two, involves bowing before the King. Bowing before the King. One of the words that is translated worship in the Bible means to bow. In Psalm 95, verse 6, it says, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. The most common Hebrew word for worship was the word shakah, which means to bow. We bow to acknowledge his lordship. We bow to acknowledge that he is our God, that we are living for him, that he is above us, and that we are submitted to him, that we trust him. We had a great men's breakfast yesterday. Our guest speaker, Don Rice, he was talking about submission, and he was talking about how when you submit to the Lord and you trust the Lord, your obedience becomes automatic. You know, when you love God and you trust God and you submit yourself to God, obedience isn't forced. It isn't difficult. You do it automatically. And this is what bowing is all about. It's coming before the Lord and making him the center of your life and worshiping him as things that are far greater. There's so many things in the New Testament, examples of people bowing down. And most of these people were not even believers when they practiced this bowing down. There were lepers and Samaritans and prostitutes that all bowed before Jesus Christ. At his birth, we read in Matthew chapter 2, verse 11, that the wise men, the magi, they came and they bowed before the little baby in the manger. Jairus, when he was asking, he was a religious ruler, when asking for healing for his daughter, he bowed down before the Lord. The rich young ruler who wasn't willing to give up his riches, he bowed before the Lord when he met him. The demoniac at the Gadarenes, we were talking about this Wednesday night, that the first act, as soon as Jesus stepped out of the boat onto to the shore, he came running and bowed down to worship Jesus. Amen. And he said these words. He says, what have I to do with you, Son of the Most High God? And I shared with the group on Wednesday night, I'll share it with you. This is something that we should all practice as believers and Christians, to bow down before Christ every day and say, what have I to do with you? What have I to do with your grace? What have I to do with your power? What have I to do with your revelation and your presence? What have I to do with your mercy, Lord God? What am I to do with your blessings, God? This is a question we should ask God every day. God, I want to fall down at your feet. And God, what am I to do with you today? Where would you have me to go? Who would you have me to talk to? I've got the presence of the creator of the universe living in me. I've got the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead living in me. I've got the power that is greater than any power there ever was living in me. I've got the revelator living in me. I've got the healer living in me. I've got the deliverer living in me. What am I to do with you today? God, I've got a resource that I don't know what to do with. What do you want me to do for you today, God? This is an act of worship. It says the demoniac fell down at his feet and worshiped him, a man that was possessed with a legion of demons. Why do we as believers find it so difficult to bow down at the feet of Jesus and worship him? When a demoniac had no problem, a prostitute had no problem, a man that wasn't even a believer, a Jew, had no problem acknowledging Jesus Christ as the Son of the Most High God. But yet we live in a world where we can't get people to worship. We can't even get people to sing or clap their hands or lift their hands sometimes. More or less bow down and worship him at his feet. Modern Christians struggle with this, because we're what the Bible calls stiff-necked. We're stiff-necked. I want you right now to just tense up the muscles in your neck. Keep your neck as straight as you can and try to bow. You can't do it. You can't bow before the Lord with a stiff neck. I don't know. I'm not talking about waking up because you slept funny and your neck is stiff. I'm talking about somebody that's not willing to bow before Jesus Christ because we're stiff-necked, because we're stubborn, because we're full of pride, because we want to have other things in our life. We don't want to bow before the Lord. And I'm not saying you can't have other things in your life. Don't get me wrong. I'm saying they can't be the center of your life. They can't be what your identity is wrapped up in. We must worship Jesus Christ. The Bible says in 2 Chronicles verse 30, or chapter 30, verse 8, it says, don't be stiff-necked as your ancestors were. Submit to the Lord. Come to his sanctuary, which he has consecrated forever. Serve the Lord your God, so that his fierce anger will turn away from you. Don't be stiff-necked. Don't be unwilling to bow before the Lord. Don't be willing to get down in his feet and just cry out to God. Say, God, what have I to do with you today? Lord, I want you to be my identity. I want you to be my security. God, I want my life to revolve around you. I don't want anything in my life to take away from the worship of you. I want to love you. I want to know you, God. I want to be with you. We can't be stiff-necked and worship the Lord at the same time. The practice of worship involves all three realms of our being. This is what I touched on last week, that God is a triune God, spirit, soul, and body. And so that God wants us to connect with him. I'm sorry, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So he wants us to connect with him, spirit, soul, and body. First, our worship involves the physical realm. It says here in Romans chapter 12, our text this morning, to present your bodies to God. Present your bodies to God. So worship involves the physical, that we need to worship God with our body. And I'm not just talking about clapping your hands. I'm not talking about lifting your hands. I'm not talking about singing per se. But it's honoring God in your body. Honoring God with the things you do physically. Honoring God in the temple. This is now the temple of the Lord. And we need to honor God in that temple. What we put into our temple. How we treat our temple. There are things that we wouldn't think of doing to the church or in the church building. But we do things to our body. And we're not realizing that it is the temple of the Lord Most High. The physical realm becomes spiritual when sacrifice is involved. I'll say that again. The physical things become spiritual when sacrifice is involved. And so sacrifice is the key in our worship to come into the presence of the Lord. The New Testament word for worship is proskuneo, which means to prostrate oneself face down to the ground in submission. You talk about bowing. You know, in the Old Testament, I get the idea they just bowed. But in the New Testament, they laid on their face before God. They took it to another level. And this is something I want to do. I want to take my worship to another level. Presenting a sacrifice meant that you released ownership of the sacrifice. Presenting a song without presenting yourself is not worship. In fact, one of the things that they did, and I think I'm jumping ahead myself here just a little bit, but when they brought an animal to the altar, they got inside the gate of the temple, and they would take their hands and they would lay it on that animal. And in essence, they were identifying with that animal, saying, I'm taking my sin and my wickedness and my impurities, and I am transferring it unto you because I want to die to these things. And as this animal's about to die, I'm taking all the negative things that I identify with, and I'm laying them on this animal because I want them to die in my life. See, identity in worship is so important that we have to identify with the sacrifice. Amen. Are you with me this morning? I just said a lot when I said that statement. We have to identify with the sacrifice. Amen. The sacrifice is the Lord Jesus Christ. Worship is identifying with the sacrifice and releasing the ownership of those things. We talked about that last week or 2 weeks ago, how making Christ Lord is all about ownership. And when they brought an animal to sacrifice, they released the ownership of that because they had laid their sins upon that thing and their evil and their flesh upon that thing, and they released ownership of that. We need to release the ownership of the wickedness, the attachment of the wicked things in our life, and put them on the altar and sacrifice them to God. Worship involves your mind. It says in verse 2 here in Romans 12, to be transformed, to be changed by the renewing of your mind. And so we have to engage our mind when we worship. You know, I catch myself sometimes doing this. I'm singing a song, but my mind is somewhere else. Am I really worshiping? No, I'm just singing a song, right? I'm thinking about what I got to do this afternoon. It's supposed to be 62 degrees. Man, it's going to be a great day. What are some things I can do outside? What is some recreational activity I can? I'm not worshiping God. I put my lips on autopilot. They're singing, but my mind is a long way from the Lord. So we have to engage our mind when we worship God. We have to put our focus, our attention, our thoughts on the Lord. There's so many scriptures in the Bible that talks about our thoughts being on the Lord. Finally, the third realm is the spiritual realm. We have to engage our spirit. The Bible says in the version that we read here in Romans chapter 12, present your bodies to God, a living sacrifice, which is your reasonable service. I love another translation says that this phrase reasonable service, the best translation of it is your spiritual worship. So when you engage your body and you engage your mind and your entire being is coming into order as you're worshiping, it is spiritual worship. Now you have gotten into the spirit realm because you're also engaging the physical and the mental side of things. You begin to enter the realm of spiritual worship. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18 says, we don't fix our eyes on the things that are seen, but on the things that are unseen. So we're worshiping, we're looking into the unseen realm, presenting a song, for what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. So we're worshiping the eternal things. We're looking at the things of the spirit realm. John chapter 4, verse 23, the conversation that Jesus has with the woman at the well. He says, the hour is coming and now is when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. So God wants us to connect with Him. He is a spirit. He wants us to connect with Him through our spirit. The spirit realm is so important when we worship. True worshipers worship beyond the physical realm of song, but they get into the spiritual things. They connect with God on a different level. Two scriptures, one Old Testament, one New, says that people honored God with their lips, but their heart was far from Him. So it's more than just the physical. You've got to engage your heart. You've got to engage your spirit when we worship. I put this quote, I'm not sure where I got it from. It might even be something the Holy Spirit showed me, but I think I got it from somewhere else. It says, the function of worship without the fire of worship prevents a release of the fragrance of worship. I'll say it again. The function of worship without the fire of worship prevents a release of the fragrance of worship. See, part of the worship, and we'll get into this as we go through the tabernacle and the temple of the Old Testament, was a release of incense, a sweet-smelling aroma that would fill the tabernacle as they were worshiping God. The Bible says our praise rises to heaven as a sweet-smelling aroma, and incense fills heaven when we praise. Well, incense has to have fire before it can happen. Amen? And so we've got to have the fire of God within us. That's one of our responsibilities as a priest, is to light a fire in our heart, is to have the fire of God within us. That's the next blank there in your conclusion, in your outline. Worship has to have three things: fire, an altar, and a sacrifice. When they got into the tabernacle, or excuse me, into the court, they would come in with singing. And when they got in, there was this altar, the altar of burnt offerings, it was called, the altar of sacrifice, it was called. And there were three elements to that. They had to have fire, they had to have an altar, and they had to have a sacrifice in order to worship. And I tell you, as a believer, I'm so into the fire of God. I want the fire of God. Amen? I don't know about you, but I want the fire of God. And I know so many believers that they might have an altar, they might have a song, but they don't have the fire of God. You can't have a sacrifice without the fire of God. For they would lay that animal on the altar, and the fire would burn the animal. It would consume the animal. And sometimes we've got sacrifices, but no fire. You can't have a sacrifice without fire. You can't bring something to God unless the fire is consuming that thing. It's not sacrifice. God wants to burn within your heart. He wants to have the fire of heaven within you. He wants the fire of His presence to be within you. And this was the process. They would build the altar. They would take the sacrifice, the first one of the day, and they would lay it on the altar. You know where the fire came from? Initially, it came from God. Heaven brought the first fire to light the fire in that altar. And you know, there was this thing, I don't have time this morning to go into the story, but there were some priests, they got fire from somewhere else. It was called profane fire. And, you know, we have sometimes, we get fired up about things, but we're not getting our excitement, we're not getting our zeal, we're not getting our identity, we're not getting our security from the presence of God. We're getting it from somewhere else. And that's the equivalent of this profane fire. Your energy, your drive, your fire, that thing that motivates you, that thing that stirs you, is not coming from the presence of God. That's profane fire. And those priests died because of that act of not honoring God. Our fire, our excitement, our focus, our identity, the things that drive us, the things that stir our hearts, need to come from the presence of God. God wants to provide a fire in your life, a fire that will wake you up in the morning, a fire that will get you going, a fire that will motivate you, a fire that will even wake you up in the middle of the night with excitement, that you've got the Spirit of God stirring within you, a fire that makes you excited to face your day, a fire that just drives you. You know, when I look at a believer and I ask them, how you doing? I'm hanging in there. They ain't got no fire. If you're just hanging in there, you ain't got no fire. They're just moping along day by day. I can't wait to get to the next paycheck. I got to make it through the week. I got to make it to the end of the month. That's not fire. That's depression. That's bondage. God wants to put a fire in your heart. Hallelujah. And so the initial fire came from God, but it was the responsibility of the priest to keep the fire burning. Look what it says here in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 12. It says, "And the fire on the altar shall be kept burning on it. It shall not be put out, and the priest shall burn wood on it every morning and lay the burnt offering in order on it, and he shall burn on it the fat and the peace offerings. A fire shall always be burning on the altar, and it shall never go out." Hallelujah. I don't know how many times you've been to a conference, a revival, a church service, and God placed a fire in your heart. And 2 weeks later, 2 months later, the fire is gone. One of the responsibilities of the priest is that when God puts a fire in your heart, it is your responsibility to keep that fire burning. And you can blame the church, you can blame God, you can blame anybody else for that fire going out. What happened? I've lost my fire. It's always somebody else's fault. But it is the responsibility of the priest. How many priests do we have in here this morning? Amen. We have to keep that fire burning. Paul said it this way in the New Testament. He told Timothy to stir up the gift of God that is in you. Another translation says, fan into flame the fire that is within you. You have to fan it into flame. You have to stir that fire within you. How do you do that? We have couple of fireplaces in our house. We have a fire pit out in the backyard. And because of the winter and the storms that we had recently, I have branches everywhere. And so last week we started a fire. We're burning a bunch of the branches and stuff. And I couldn't get the fire going at first. And you see a little glow of orange and maybe some white embers down there. And you all know how frugal your pastor is. I didn't want to keep using that butane lighter because those things, yeah, I hate buying those things, you know. So I know there's fire there, man, and I put some dry leaves on it, put some sticks on there. But the thing that really got the fire going was I would bend down. I would blow on those embers. And eventually those embers would catch those leaves or those little sticks, and it would get that fire going again. Stirring the fire, stoking the fire. One of the things that we can do to stir the fire of God is to get in His presence, whether it's through His word or prayer or worship, and let the breath of the Holy Spirit, the wind of God, blow on those embers in your heart. There are embers glowing, whether they're white or orange, I don't know, but they are in your heart. They are there. And if you will just get in the presence of God or get on your knees and not be so stiff-necked and kneel down before the Lord or get into the Word of God, you'll find the pneuma, the breath of God begin to blow on those embers, and that fire will come back in you. That fire of the presence of God will come. God said, I will never leave you or forsake you. That means those embers are there. Hallelujah. But if you don't blow on those things and you don't do anything with those things, it'll be tough to have a fire in you. But if you get into the presence of God, if you get on your faith, if you lift your hand, if you bring that sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord, you are blowing on those embers of the presence of God in your heart, and you are reigniting that fire that God has placed within you. Hallelujah. We need to do this often. Exodus 29 verse 37 tells us that whatever touched the altar became holy. It says, 7 days thou shalt make an atonement for the altar and sanctify it, and it shall be an altar most holy. Whatsoever touches the altar shall be holy. Hallelujah. See, God wants to bring a sense of holiness and purity into your life. He doesn't create the altar to inflict pain upon you. You know, we think, Pastor, you know, that altar stuff, that's talking about burning and burning flesh and death and things like that. It wants to burn out the impurity and the sin. See, they laid their hands on that animal and imparted their sin to that animal. And so it wasn't burning the good things. It was burning all the garbage in their life. See, the altar is all about holiness. It is all about getting the impurities out of your life before you go into the presence of God. Because the priest, if they went into the presence of God with impurities in their life, what would happen to them? They'd drop dead. See, God wants to have that face-to-face, pure relationship with you. The Bible says that the pure in heart shall see God. God wants to reveal Himself to you in ways that'll blow your mind. But the impurities of our heart keep us from experiencing the fullness of God. And so this is what the altar is all about. It's all about experiencing the fullness of God. And in order to do that, you've got to burn out the impurities of your life through the sacrifice at the altar, getting rid of those things that would keep you from hearing more clearly from God, from experiencing the presence of God, from seeing the face of God. These are the things that God wants to do. And the fire of God would consume what was laid on the altar. Hallelujah. It's interesting, this passage of Scripture says to present yourself a living sacrifice. Now, in the Old Testament, The Israelites would bring their sacrifice and they would hand it to the priest, and the priest would lay the sacrifice on the altar. But who's the priest in the New Testament? We are. So Paul says, present yourself. In the New Testament, we're not only the priest, we're also the sacrifice. Amen? And he says, present yourself a living sacrifice. I was worshiping this morning and the Lord was speaking to my heart, and he says, you know that area up in the front there, what do you call that? an altar, right? And so I come and I knelt down here at the altar. I was presenting myself to the Lord, a living sacrifice, laying at the altar. You know, we encourage people when you worship to come forward. And you might think, Pastor, what difference? It's symbolic of being that living sacrifice, putting yourself on the altar, saying, God, here I am. God, burn out the sin, burn out the impurities, because I want more of you in my life. I don't want anything keeping me from seeing you. I want to go into the Holy of Holies, and I can't do it with impurity. I can't do it with sin. I can't do it with the things of this world that have attached themselves to me. I think it's interesting, if you look at the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, when Nebuchadnezzar threw them into the fiery furnace, did they burn? No. What burned? The ropes, right, that they tied their hands and feet with? The only thing that burned in that fire was the thing that the world tried to bind them with, right? The soldiers tied them with their hands and their feet with ropes. And they looked in there later and they said, are they cooking? And they said, no, they're walking around loosed. The ropes are gone. See, this is what sacrifice is all about. God is not looking to burn up and consume anything of value in your life. Fire purifies. Fire makes things more valuable. Fire refines things. This is what God wants to do. He wants to burn off those things that the world tries to bind you with so that you can be loosed. And then what happened once they were loosed? The fourth man, the presence of the Son of God came and was in that fire with them. See, God wants to show up in your life in a greater measure, but that happens through sacrifice. Through coming and laying yourself on the altar and saying, God, here's my life. Here's all the things that I identify with, that I'm wrapped up in, that are not of you, Lord. I want my identity. I want my security. I want my life to revolve around you, Lord God. And so I lay myself on the altar, a living sacrifice. See, God does not end our life, but he gives us his life in exchange. That change of identity happens at the altar of sacrifice. We become a living sacrifice, not a dead. Every sacrifice in the Old Testament became a dead sacrifice. But Christ wants you to be a living sacrifice. And it all began with the resurrection. Jesus Christ is a living sacrifice. Amen. He put himself on that cross, and they thought that he was dead. But in Christ Jesus, through sacrifice, true life comes. Eternal life comes. That's what it means. Jesus was the first living sacrifice, a sacrifice that they thought was dead, but the death could not hold him. The tomb could not hold him. The grave could not hold him. It was the sacrifice that brought real life, resurrection life, eternal life to not just him, but to you and I. Hallelujah. And this is what sacrifice to God is, not a death. It's the beginning of resurrection. It's the beginning of life. And this is what I don't want to get into preaching my Easter message this morning, but it's what life is all about. Paul wrote these things in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. He says, my old self has been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who lives, but Christ who lives in me. You talk about identity. Paul says, through my sacrifice, I've been crucified with Christ, and my identity has changed. It's no longer I that lives, but Christ that lives in me. I identify with the Lord Jesus Christ. I've taken his name. I call myself a Christian, a Christian, because I'm identified with him in his death and his burial and his resurrection. I no longer present myself based on my activity, based on my occupation, my vocation. That's not what my identity is. My identity is found in Christ and Christ alone. Hallelujah. I don't identify me by some physical feature. I don't identify myself by my social status or my bank account or my degree. I identify myself as a child of the Most High God, because there is nothing more greater. There is nothing greater. There is nothing of greater worth. There is nothing of greater value. There is nothing more valuable, is what I meant to say, than having Christ in my life. I worship the thing that I value the most. I worship the thing that I identify with the most. What do you identify with the most? What do you value the most? Where do you spend your time, your energy, your finances? That is what you worship. I worship the Lord Jesus Christ, and him only do I serve. And so I bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. I don't just bring my praises. The Bible says bring the sacrifice of praise. If there's no sacrifice involved, it really isn't truly worship. Amen? And there's a lot of people, well, I go if I feel up to it. I worship when I have time. I worship when I'm able. That's not a sacrifice. It's not a sacrifice. Sacrifice only happens when you step beyond the realm of convenience. I'll say that again. Sacrifice only happens when you step beyond the realm of convenience or what's easy. That's when it becomes a sacrifice. How many of you, it wasn't easy to get here this morning? Yeah, you brought a sacrifice with you. How many of you didn't feel like coming to church this morning? Amen? Now, that's a sacrifice. How many of you looked at the weather and said, man, I'd rather stay home today? Sacrifice, right? That's what worship is all about. It's all about sacrifice. And before they could even get into the holy place or think about the glory of God, they had to stop at the place of sacrifice. Next week, we're going to continue this and talk about the great triumphal entry on Palm Sunday. Let's bow our heads this morning. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you desire to have a relationship with us where nothing stands between you and us, Lord. One that is pure, one that is holy, one that is intimate, Lord. God, we often have so many things that stand in the way. We want to sacrifice those things, Lord. We want to bring this carcass, this body, this flesh, our mind, and present them in spiritual worship on the altar today, Lord. Ask you to forgive us, to cleanse us, Lord. We want you to be the center of our life, God. We want to experience your glory. We want to see you face to face, Lord. We want to be in that holy of holies, to come before your throne with boldness and confidence to obtain grace and mercy, Lord. So, God, we lift you up today, Father. And I pray, God, if there's anybody here today that has something to lay on the altar, it's not comfortable, not convenient, it's not easy, but I pray, God, that they would present those things right now to you. Just take a minute. Just make an altar right where you're at with your heart, your mind. It doesn't have to be physical, but if you want to kneel, you can kneel. Just give these things to the Lord this morning. God, just lay them at your feet. Lack of faith, prayerlessness, Lord God. The covetousness, pride, the lust, the fear. All of those things, Lord God, we lay it at your feet today, God. All the filth and impurity, Lord, that keeps us from seeing you, Lord, and experiencing you, Lord. Burn it out of our life today, God. We want to be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to you. That is the goal of spiritual worship, Lord. Hallelujah.